Hello, this video will look at SAS Viya Topologies. The previous videos in this series looked at the default deployment topologies, using node labels and taints, and how to control the deployment topology. We looked at the use of the five node pools, the default node pools, as shown below, and we discussed something that I called scaling by tier. Now, this is great for scaling for performance tuning, but it may not be a low-cost approach. So in this video, we'll look at simplified lower-cost topologies. But first, we'll start by looking at the platform design drivers. You need to understand the platform design drivers. So understanding these drivers, we can categorize them into three areas. Speed, is performance the primary driver? Or perhaps availability, high availability could be the primary driver for the platform design. Or perhaps cost, might be the primary driver that the platform cost should be kept to a minimum. When we're thinking about performance, it is typically acceptable performance within the constraints. The main constraint is usually budget or cost. There are also many non-functional requirements that can have an impact on the infrastructure requirements and hence the costs. For example, performance, availability, or even security can introduce new or additional components. The availability requirements can have a significant impact on cost. And we usually say that the last nine of availability that you purchase is, or configure is the most expensive IT cost. So understanding the recovery time objectives and recovery point objectives is key when defining the right approach to get the right platform design. With that in mind, what does simplifying the topology mean? What does simplify mean? Within this context, it could be reducing the number of node pools that are required. You don't have to have a dedicated node pool for each tier or component type or category, using the five default node pools that we've previously discussed. Or it could be to remove the clustering and the number of pod replicas required. So you don't cluster the stateful services. Again, if you remember, the default configuration is to have high availability configured for the stateful services. So reducing the number of pods can help reduce the infrastructure requirements and hence the costs. It's key to remember that it's not mandatory to use the five default node pools. But you may still want to dedicate resources to some things like the analytics engines. For example, dedicating resources to the CAS server or the programming workload, the SAS compute server. The key driver for having different node pools is the requirement to have specific hardware. For example, for the SAS compute server or the CAS server, you may want to have instance types that have GPU support enabled, or a specific amount or number of CPU and amount of RAM configured. Remember that all nodes within a node pool are identical. Therefore, having multiple node pools can give you increased granularity of the infrastructure costs by allowing you to choose specific instance types for the different types of components. So having fewer node pools may not reduce the overall costs. We still had the minimum requirements for running the system. I would now like to discuss the first of two examples. The first one here is using two node pools. So in this example, we have a general node pool which has been set up for what I've called everything other than CAS. And then we have our CAS node pool. which allows resources to be dedicated to CAS processing. It also allows us to select specific hardware or instance types that will be used for running the CAS pods. And if the workload can fit in a single node, we could use an SMP CAS server. Otherwise, you could still use an MPP CAS server. It also assumes that the programming workload or the SAS compute server processing is not large or doesn't require dedicated nodes. So if we look at this in more detail, we can see that we've got our two different node pools here. So on the left, we have our general node pool, and that's running our stateful pods, our stateless pods, our connect and compute pods. In the middle, we have our CAS node pool, which is running our CAS server. And in the right-hand side here, you can see that we still have a default node pool. And this could be used for running the ingress controller, cert manager, and perhaps other components like the SAS Viya monitoring for Kubernetes components. We've also applied some labels and taints. So our general node pool, we've applied the compute label here to enable the pre-pull for the SAS compute server. And in the middle here, we can see in the CAS node pool, we've applied the workload class of CAS as a label and a taint. Looking at the node pools, we can see here for the general node pool, we could configure it to have a minimum number of nodes of 0 and a maximum number of nodes of 2. Perhaps when things are running, you would end up with this state where we've got 2 nodes. And as we discussed in the other videos, by default, Kubernetes will randomly schedule the pods across the available nodes, in this case, the 2 nodes within the node pool. But the pod affinity and anti-affinity settings will also drive the pod placement. We can see in the CAS node pool here, we've got a single node running the SMP CAS server, and perhaps again, we've configured the node pool to have a minimum number of nodes of 0, and in this case, a maximum of 1. And finally, the default node pool, because we want the system services always to be available, perhaps this has got a static value of 1, so minimum of 1 and maximum of 1, and we've got a single node supporting the default node pool. So as I've said, to support the pre-pull function for the SAS compute server, the label there of the workload class equals compute is added to that general node pool. We also had the workload class equals CAS label and taint, which has been added to the nodes in the CAS node pool. And this allows us to dedicate those nodes to the CAS processing. Depending on the cost or performance objectives, auto-scaling of the general node pool could be used. So there's a decision here. Should I use a single larger node or multiple smaller nodes? But if you note the footnote there at the bottom, that depending on the platform or the cloud provider, there are limits on the number of pods per node, and this may mandate the use of multiple nodes. So scaling could be required also to support the SAS compute server processing. The second example I'd like to discuss is using 3 node pools. As you can see here in this model, we have a services node pool for our stateless and stateful services. We have our compute node pool, and this allows for resources to be dedicated to the programming or SAS compute server processing. It also allows for specific hardware to be used for the SAS compute server pods. And then we have the CAS node pool as before. And once again, this allows resources to be dedicated to the CAS processing. It allows for specific hardware to be used for the CAS pods. And if the workload can fit on a single node, we could use an SMP CAS server. If not, we can use an MPP CAS server. Looking at this in more detail, once again, we can see our Kubernetes cluster and our SAS Viya namespace. And on the left here, we have our services node pool. And this is running our stateful and stateless pods. We then have our compute node pool, and it's for running our compute pods. And we can see we've applied our workload class of compute as a label and taint to the nodes in this node pool. We then once again have our CAS node pool, and again we've applied a label and taint to the nodes within that node pool. And finally on the right, we've got the default node pool. If we wanted to keep other pods away from running on that services node pool, or the nodes within the node pool, we would need to apply a taint to that. So we could use one of the default workload classes here. And if you remember, the stateful pods and stateless pods can actually tolerate the taint of each other. So we could use a workload class label and taint for either stateful or stateless here, or perhaps we could use a custom label of services and place that label and taint on all the nodes within this node pool. Again, looking at our node pools in more detail, perhaps the services node pool has been configured to have a minimum of one node and a maximum of four. In this example, I'm showing that we've got two nodes currently running in that services node pool. And as described previously, the stateful and the stateless pods are being distributed over the nodes as per the scheduling rules that have been set up. In the compute node pool, we've got a definition here that's showing a minimum of one and maximum of two. In our CAS node pool, again, this might have a static value, and we're showing a minimum of one, maximum of one, and we're using this to support our SMP CAS server. And finally, our default node pool might have a minimum of one and maximum of two. Perhaps this is a slightly more busier environment, and we, as you can see, we're using the three node pool pattern because we've got a reasonable number of compute or programming users, as well as our visual programming and CAS workloads. Perhaps the instance types have been set like this. Again, this is to illustrate that each node pool can have a different configuration, and all the nodes within the node pool have the same configuration or are the same instance type. So perhaps in this example, the services node pool is using an instance type with 8 vCPUs and 56 gigabytes of RAM. Our compute node pool has got this instance type 2, if you like, which has got 8 CPUs and 64 gig of RAM. To support our CAS processing, we've got an instance type of 3 here. So our third one is 16 vCPUs with more memory in it. And finally, for our default node pool or system node pool, we've got a instance type 4, as it labeled here. Now, this is just an example, and it's in no way a formal sizing recommendation, but I did want to illustrate that the purpose of the node pools is to allow you to configure the instance types to suit the workloads that are running within that node pool. Using that three node pool pattern, nodes are dedicated to the programming users, so the SAS compute server workload, and to the CAS server processing. This allows us to have specific instance types that can be used for each of these. And this could be due to CPU or memory requirements. It would also allow us to use local storage to be provisioned for things like SAS work and the CAS disk cache. And depending on the cost or performance objectives, auto-scaling of the compute node pool could be used. So we have a decision here. Do we use a single node, or do we use multiple smaller nodes? and scaling could be required to support the SAS compute server processing. And this is for environments that have a high number of compute server sessions that have a high CPU and memory requirement. And this may lead to very high peaks or a very variable workload. So it would lend itself quite naturally to having a node pool that can dynamically grow, if you like, up and down. To summarize, there are many factors that have an influence on the infrastructure costs. We have only discussed the Kubernetes nodes and node pools and talked about creating these simplified topologies to focus on lowering the infrastructure costs. But storage options also need to be assessed when looking at the total platform costs. The two node pattern is good for environments with minimal programming workloads. For example, reporting environments running the SAS Visual Analytics solution. And you should consider using the three node pattern if there is a reasonable programming workload. To summarize this a bit further, the number of stateful pod replicas can be adjusted to reduce the resource requirements. This assumes that high availability is not required and would use a single pod for each of the stateful services. You could also use a minimal configuration for Elasticsearch. Vertical and horizontal scaling is still possible. So vertical scaling within our Kubernetes context is using larger nodes, while the horizontal scaling is using multiple nodes or perhaps multiple node pools with nodes in them. And node pool scaling doesn't have to be large. For example, you could set the minimum number of nodes to 0 or 1, and the maximum number of nodes could be just 2 or 3. Allowing a node pool to scale to zero can help to reduce the costs. You would use this for environments that don't have to be always on, for example, a test environment or a lab environment. But there are some things to consider. If you're running in the cloud, this assumes that you've purchased the instances on an hourly or spot pricing basis. And scaling to zero may not make any difference if we're using reserved instances, so the instances have been purchased on a yearly pricing plan. But this can have an impact on performance and startup times as new nodes are started to meet the workload demands. The minimum number of nodes may also be influenced by the Kubernetes and cloud provider limits. For example, there is a limit to the number of pods you can have running on each node. Finally, the size and number of nodes can impact performance and startup times, as I discussed a moment ago. You don't want to scale your platform down so small that startup takes a long time or things may fail to start.